Thanks, Vivek. Let us start with the panel discussion. EPC and O&M. So if we look at four pillars of solar power industry, of course the DISCOM on one side and the other three which are in the market, the end customer, many times the developer, and EPC, and of course I would club O&M maybe along with that. The customer is the king, so end customer always has his way. The developer is the one who is investing his money or his or her own money. So the maximum risk is borne by the investor or developer. So naturally the returns are going to the developer. What happens to EPC? How many of us in the audience are from EPC side? Can you raise your hands? Okay, thank you. It was also a sanity check. How many of you are sleeping? Being serious, so that's where the criticality of EPC and O&M is. Whenever we are dealing, or actually we are closing the deals, I feel the pillar which is under most stress is the EPC person. Customer wants the lowest PPA rate, that means lowest EPC rate, and that's imperative on an EPC player how to bring it down. And that opens many questions. One, how do you make sure that going down the route, an EPC is not compromising on the quality? As a customer, how would he make a decision? And I have come across people going crazy numbers, 24 quotations, 24 EPC parties they invited. How would they make a decision which one is better? Right? The system is installed. How would you make sure the performance is as per guarantee? That's where O&M comes in. Can we have a standard so that customers or even developers can assess all the EPC players? Does technology play any role in it, or is it only the cost or the price that is going into it? I think these are all the questions that come to mind. And I think each one of us here on the dais can contribute on this one. So I would like to start from the technology part, because price is always coming, and I, as a salesperson, I want it at the end, and start with the technology. So Sachin, question to you, that how much do you see technology playing role as an EPC player in solar installations? So be it starting with electrical design, civil work, the structural design, of course the electronics that goes into it. So that's one. And what are the technological advances these days? So different types of, Vivek shared about the panels and different types, also in case of inverter, etc. So that's what I would like you to cover.
Thank you. I would just putting in few points regarding the commercial risk that the EPC player is coming into before getting into the technical part. Now, I was into discussion with one of the customer, and he is put up a very genuine question to me. You are saying that the module power output after 10 years would be 90%, and after 25 years it is 80% of the rated output power. But the product warranty what you are giving me is 10 years. So if you are not, technically you are not very sure that your product is even going to last after 10 years, what is the point in giving a power output warranty after 25 years? To me, the question seems to be very reasonable. Either you say my power output after 10 years would be 90% and my product warranty is 10 years, or you raise your product warranty to 25 years and then you say that after 25 years, the power output warranty would be 80%. So this is one thing. Second thing is, when we talk about the generation guarantees and the performance bank guarantees, as a EPC player, we should be very, very clear whether we wanted to get into a trap. I would put it very blatantly as a trap only, where the module guys, they are not giving you any guarantees, whereas as a EPC, everyone wants you to submit all the performance bank guarantee to the customer. And we know the status of the many of the module players. Probably they are there since last 2-3 years, but right now they are nowhere in the market. So your warranties are there with the customer, but then you don't have any backup available with you. So you need to think through what are the commercial terms and conditions that you are going to agree. Then one more thing, recently I was into discussion with one of the customer. The building is 70 meters tall building and it is very windy there. The customer want to further elevate the structure by another 7 meters because he wanted to utilize the area underneath it. But because of some restrictions, he cannot put the shade over the roof because again it will get into the FSI and all those stuff. So what was his requirement from the EPC player is, I do not want any leakage from my elevated structures. So probably you seal all the modules through the silicon adhesive or whatever some person has educated him that you can put in the silicon adhesives between the modules and you can close the entire entire gaps in the structures. I said fair enough. I had spoken to a few of the friends in the from the module side. We said this is a very new thing that has come up in India. We are not aware. Although for some of the guys in US they had done it, but for the very small size. And once we had done the entire analysis, the strat2 analysis and all the uplift for the wind, we had clearly told to the end customer that this is something whosoever is telling you that it can be done. Technically, it is not possible. So, means as a EPC, this is our responsibility that what is the correct thing, we should tell it to the end customer and we should educate him in a correct way. Rather than fighting between ourselves and guiding customer and taking him to a wrong path, I should say. Now coming to the technology part, again I will distribute it into a ground mounted and the rooftop. Specifically coming to again the design of the plant itself, I'm not very sure how much we as a Indian, I should say, how much we are confident about our designing of the system, solar system itself. Probably if I ask 10 technical guys here to design the solar plant with this particular piece of land and this, with this grading and latitude, longitude, I will get 10 different tilt and 10 different pitch. And this is actually, I had done the analysis between my company itself and all my design guys had come up with a different answers to me. So we need to just think through before, because whatever you are putting it on the drawing board, it is very critical. Because once it is executed on the ground, it is executed on the ground and it is going to be there for next 25 years. Probably a day will come when everybody will come and say, sir, there is no need of a structure itself. We can put it on the ground and we can use it. So we need to think through as a EPC and as a good technical company is where we are moving. And if anybody has actually realized how we are putting in the structures, what we are either we are doing the piling, we are just putting the stub, we do the concreting, we do the stat2 report also, but that stat2 report is not, it is independent. There are two reports. One is the structure part. So the guy will say the structure is it's able to withstand so much wind speed, but he will never give with this civil combination or the civil engineering and the structure engineering, including both, it is going to last for next 25 years or it is going to sustain this much wind speed. Both would be independent. So just think through on this technical sides what we are doing. On the again on the structure side, again there are a lot of new technology which is coming up. In fact, yesterday one guy has come to me that, sir, we have now come up with a new design wherein instead of hot dip galvanized structure, you can use a plastic embedded structure which is going to last for 25 years. Now, I'm not very sure whether it is going to be there, whether it is going to take the wind load or not, but yes, probably it is 30 to 40% cheaper than a typical steel structure plant will have. So, we just need to think through at what point we are moving on the technical side and compromising on the quality of the plant.
Thanks. I think that's the important factor. Tata in India is a name which is identified with quality and minimum standards in their all the products. So Arun Kumar, I would like you to ask a question that when we are in a rat race like this in solar sector, where every inch we want to save, every penny or rupee we want to save, every unit of generation we want to increase. How do you define standards in such case? Because in today I see a huge vacuum there. We talk about IEC. Does really IEC give any confidence to customer in terms of the basic level of, I mean, quality? Is that really a good parameter? Because each and every EPC, be it a new startup or an established player like Tata, will always say IEC compliant, and various standards are thrown in front of, on our faces. So how do you see on this count?
Very good question and very relevant question for us. What has happened very recently, if you have seen the news which has come up, BIS has stepped in now. BIS had said, irrespective whether you have an IEC standard, there is also an BIS standard, IS standard. So I think all the EPCs have got now a tough time that if you bring the modules from China, you need to get it certified here. And unless you get it certified here, you cannot put it up in this Indian part. That's one good thing which has happened. The reason behind it is, if you look in many cases, especially in Rajasthan, hot and humid climate, some of these panels, you talk about whatever technology, I'm talking about thin films and crystalline. When you talk about thin films somewhere down the line, you had a lot of failures in thin films. The reason attributed to this was basically hot and humid climate. Even First Solar, someone had made a comment on this, they require more inventories in such climatic conditions. IEC as a standard for modules is 61215 and 61730. There are two basic standards which is required. One is for safety and another type test. So if this test has to come to India, there are other parameters which has to be looked into it. Of course, the standard is made somewhere, either in Swiss or somewhere else. They have taken their climatic conditions. But when you come to our sort of hot and humid climate, there is some little tweaking of standard is required. Probably that's what BIS has looked into it. Probably we have yet to read between lines what they have done. So if that comes, then I think probably it would be a good thing for many players who are going for modules to come to a certain standard. Now, if you ask me which is the best module, if we have Jinko here. Jinko said he is the best module. Tomorrow you go to someone else, he'll say my module is the best, Ryzen is the best, he'll say. He'll give you some 101 reasons for that. Now you are stuck. Now, how do you rate these panels is a big question today. You have a standard, yeah, he is qualified. Is 61215 qualified, 6173 qualified, he shows you the certificate. Then what else do you need more now? You are stuck somewhere. So I think probably this is one good thing which happened now recently. BIS has said, okay guys, come what may, you have an IEC standard, get it certified by us and let us move forward. Now that's one thing. Then certain things which I would like also tell is there is something like the risk which has been happening in many of these power plants. Why this is happening is because we are not being able to build power plants with some sort of a safety and quality into it. MNRE, if you look at the last page or of the document, they have said you have to install each and every component which goes into the power plant should be either IEC or IS certified. Okay, that is where the document stops. Now, is there any standard which is there how to build a plant with safety and quality built into it? Yes, there is a standard which is known as IEC 62446 standard, which talks about safety and quality of how to build a plant. If you see some of these power plant which has come right from the JNSSM first, second, third phase, nowhere there's a regulation which has come in India which says the power plant has to be built with this standard in force. You only said about the components, but what happens when it comes to the power plant, there's no, it's totally silent. This is the reason why you see many of the power plants are not performing to its peak. There is somewhere lot many plants have failed also. Now this standard, how it can be implemented, there's one good thing which happened again about 6 months back. When you look at the rooftop sector as such, MNRE has brought a guidelines now. There is a book which is available, you can go to the website, check for this book, it is freely downloadable. It says guidelines to solar rooftops. Please read this document somewhere down the line, they have mentioned this standard. Actually, it's not meant for this, but at least there is a standard which is required now, how to go about building a rooftop. So amount of discipline has been brought into it, which is a good sign. And I think we have Mr. Satish here. I was also talking to him some time back. He was talking about Karnataka being very friendly, and a lot of people, you know, the tariff around 9.54 was given. Then I asked him one question, sir, good, but anyone in this 100 and odd application or 200 odd application which you got, has anyone done a pre-feasibility study? I asked him. I mean, in the news also it came, some people without rooftops have already been signed PPA. That's a different story altogether, okay? We'll not touch upon it. But before signing the PPA, has any pre-feasibility study done? There are a lot of roofs. I mean, just touching upon small things on risk and standards, how it plays an important role. The roofs which are not accessible, for example, you take a big godown. How do you go to the rooftop? There's no ladder. You look at many of these big godowns which are there, FCI godown or something. You want to put a rooftop. How do you go about? It's a challenge. Okay, all said and done, you put a scaffolding and then go on the rooftop, put the solar. Who's going to clean the panel? Next challenge is, who's going to clean? Where is the water for cleaning these panels for a period of time? People have never looked at this small thing of pre-feasibility study. Then coming to the land, a lot of EPC players are here. You know what, you know, sort of a land which we get many of the places, a lot of undulations. I had a customer who came from Andhra Pradesh. He said, I've got acres of land. I want to put a solar plant. I said, let's do a pre-feasibility study. Let us do an energy assessment. When we went to the land, it was fully rocky. Lot of rocks, undulations, you know, so much of undulation. If we had to level this and make, it would have costed him a fortune, actually. So we said, not possible. Or you want to spend this much money and build a plant, not an issue. Now people have been talking about Rajasthan for quite some time. Many plants have come up in Rajasthan. But one small thing, you need module cleaning. Where is the water in the desert? No one thought about it. Now today, if you want to clean the panel, there's a big mafia. You will have to pay them whatever they ask, otherwise you don't get water. And that also, it's rationed out. You don't clean the panel, no generation. You're caught in that sort of a thing. There's another gentleman, I'll tell you. Land was good, everything was good. Unfortunately, when we did a study, we came to know that the substation didn't have the capacity to take this 5 megawatt or 10 megawatt. Gone. You might have had a good land, everything was there. So see the amount of risks which are happening in all this, because people are not looking at this risk in the first place. I mean, I can go on, like so many things are there like this, you know. So I think standard and also the risk mitigation measures to be undertaken before you venture into this sort of an activity, solar plant. But ultimately what happens if you don't do this, they blame the technology. The EPC blames the module manufacturer blames the inverter. So the blame games goes on. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Arun Kumar. That reminds me of a news I was reading on the flight from Pune today, that you mentioned about temperature variation. There are two airlines in India who have reported problems with the engines, P&W engines. And when the analysis was conducted by P&W, they concluded that humidity levels in India and huge temperature variation across India within the same day, their engines are not designed. You can imagine reading such article at 35,000 feet, what would have been my condition? But that's relevant to Indian kind of context as well. I mean, the Westerners, especially when they designed or developed these panels, did they really anticipate so much of variation in temperature? At the same time, humidity levels. So that's one need to think. Thanks for bringing that point. And another, I want to share an interesting case. When we are finalizing contracts with customers, they are very, very strict about their safety norms and health, safety and hazard. They insisted that a lifeline has to be provided on the roof. Also, I mean, I fully agree, we have to do that. But when the plant was ready and our team went for operations and maintenance, the ladder that was provided to access the roof, that was a monkey ladder that was provided by the customer. So everyone has to be mindful about what standards we are going to use. Let us move on to the next. We have the only lady panelist here, so I would like to ask her next point. Fourth partner I know are competing in Indian EPC market, and they bring in many times very innovative designs. That's what probably is need of the hour for all EPCs to stand out themselves. So on that count, I would request Abhinanda to share her experience in terms of what different things or what things they are doing in a different way. Also, they have been consistently doing projects under SECI, and that's another area topic by itself. So how is your experience dealing with agency like SECI?
So first I'll touch on to the innovations that we are doing. Basically, like being an EPC player, like we have so many EPC players in India, but we should have an edge to sustain in this market. And for that, like, I think always we need to innovate something, like something new has to be given to the client so that he finds it like it makes him like it gives an edge for him. So that's how, like, I'll tell, for example, like as Mr. Sachin was saying about the mounting structures, like same, like when we are approaching the clients, we faced like they didn't want any holes to be drilled on the roof. We have come across many of the clients. So then we came up with a solution where there'll be like no drilling of holes. It'll be like we have that copyright technology wherein we use some special techniques to put up the modules on the tin shed roof without drilling holes. So that is one option. Then second, if you see like we have like this energy storage solutions. There again, like of course, grid pushing onto the grid is an easier option. But along with that, if you have some energy storage, when the grid is not there, we can utilize the solar. So that is something which we have done, and like it's something which is coming in the market soon. So that is the hybrid systems. The utilization of the battery banks, a small battery bank, because investment into the batteries is not a feasible option like always. So like having a small battery bank and utilizing it for the energy storage solutions, that is there. Then comes the monitoring part. Like, see, like we are having the plans to have 100 gigawatt by 2022. So for that, like, and the Make in India option is also there. So fourth partner, what we do is like we have our own team. We have the we have developed this monitoring options, because see, once the plant is installed, the work doesn't end there, because the plant has to run for 25 years. So a regular monitoring of the health of the health and the performance of the plant is very important. So again, that is something which the clients look into, and we have provided the solution as well. So that is again in-house developed. So being an EPC player with in-house capabilities is an edge. That is the need of the hour. That's what we feel. Now coming to the SECI issue, like since we have done lot many projects, and like we are allotted 12 megawatt of projects under SECI. So when we are approaching the, like this is one of the challenges that we have faced. When we are approaching the government buildings, they are not aware that they have the option to put up solar. Like under SECI, it's like they don't have to invest any money. So that is an advantage. They have to give just the roof. But again, for that also the government buildings are not ready. They have the question in their mind, what happens if you put up solar and something happens to the roof? Still those questions come in. So that thing needs to be arrested, like which we are working on, because that awareness amongst the mass has to be done. That is there. And along with that also, like we approach these apartments and residential complexes. In Karnataka, we have the gross metering, the net metering, both is there. So for residences, the hospitals and educational institutes, we get gross metering. So they have the concerns whether they'll get the money. Even before like investing, like these questions come in. So like not just like as EPC players, we need the help, of course, from the government as well, like where it is like regularized and it is like all in a process, in a place, then it will help, I guess, in the long run. So that's what is there. And also the safety is another point. Like we have to take care of the lifelines, the walkways, these things. Many people, like nowadays in the EPC market, what happens is per watt peak what you are giving. But these are some of the important things that we have to look into. Then only like, see, like ultimately once the plant is commissioned, then the O&M comes in, the cleaning of the modules comes in. Like, so all these things has to be like Mr. Arun was saying, like there are some standards. So like we have to also stick to it as an EPC player. If we ensure that all the standards are maintained, the certifications are in place, then I think like India is going to achieve the targets very soon. Like that's what I feel. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhinanda. We are talking about quality. We heard from Tata regarding the standards that we need to maintain. Bosch is the name which stands for quality, we all know. I want to hear from Niranjan that how does he strike the balance between offering the right price for a very good quality, because customers expect very high quality but at the same time low price. So how do you really balance this situation? Also, how do you see the distributed solar market? We are talking about 40 gigawatt. Most of us are convinced we are not going to make it to 40. But how and what are the factors that will drive this market? Niranjan. And can I request the next one to be precise? We'll run short of time. So
I will talk less, so I'll be very precise. okay. Like what Suhas was talking about, the total market for rooftop has been around 40 gigawatts. But what we have done till March 2017 would have been about 1.3 gigawatts. So we are a long way off. And from what I understand from Bridge to India, who are consultants in the solar field, and they estimate that it will happen, the distributed solar or the rooftop segment would reach about 13 gigawatts by 2022. So from 1.3 gigawatts to hit the target of 13 gigawatts is an exponential growth which is required every year. And this is going to be a challenge. So a lot of things depends on the rooftop segment to grow would be the kind of policies. Government has come out with some excellent policies, but in terms of implementation of policy, it could be the net metering, the various issues which are there associated with that. Coming in terms of, if you look at most of the plants, like Arun talked about quality and talked about BIS standards, Abhinandan, she also talked about the quality issues which are there. But if you look at, once again, the Bridge to India survey, they talked about a CEO survey which was taken. 56% of the CEOs came back and said that the quality of the plans which are there implemented across in the last few years is not up to the mark. So this is the most significant part. I mean, especially when a customer wants to put up a rooftop solar on his plant, the most important thing is what kind of a quality player does he choose and how does he choose a player? And that becomes the most significant part. Most of the time it is cost, time and quality which is at play. And I have seen a lot of players who are selecting a bunch of EPC players based on a certain set of quality, etc. And then they're putting them on a reverse auction. And then you can expect what you can get out of the end of the day. When people start going on a reverse auction and bidding on the price front, then it obviously what ultimately results is a bad quality, product which finally comes out because nobody is there in for charity. So what do we do in Bosch? For us, the most important thing is quality is a part of the DNA for us, and we walk away from projects straight away. We find that it does not make economical, profitable sense to work. We just walk away from the project. Now, how many of the EPCs who are out there who are ready to do that is a big question for us. We operate both on the supply side as well as on the demand side. We are on the energy efficiency part and the supply side. So we offer a comprehensive solution to customers. So when we go back to our customers, we identify the right kind of customers who would listen to us, and those are the customers whom we pitch for quality. It's going to be a big challenge for everybody, and customers, when they choose the EPC player, they need to understand whether this EPC player is going to be there in the market for the next 25 years. Because they are investing their whole plant for the next 25 years. Is he going to be there So this is some fundamental question. The industry is changing. Eventually, you will find that a lot of consolidations will happen. Probably from 1,000 to 2,000 EPCs, you will find a bunch of EPCs who will be out there, who will be differentiated, who will stand out. And we would like to be there as that part of the segment. With that, I would like to end this. Thanks, Suhas.
Yeah, Niranjan, thank you. I think your last point is important. Only those who will survive, they will be with good quality. And today, one of the challenge for this sector, especially in distributed power, is very low entry level barrier. When we look at 10 kilowatt, 20 kilowatt systems, even the electrical contractors many times think they can come and install solar systems, and they do, they can. But is that a really good quality? How do we even gear up them as well as others also adopt?